Now we go to our keynote addresses. Our first speaker will be Honorable Dr. Wijeyedasa Rajapaksa. I understood that the name have a very specific and very nice meaning. I wish Mr. Ministers will explain the meaning of your name before you speak. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you very much. Honorable Chairman, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I am going to speak on the topic designated the role of parliaments for promoting the culture of peace and implementing sustainable development goals. There can be no development without peace, and there can be no peace without development. Therefore, it is vital to understand the interlinkages between the 17 goals of the SDGs and its underpinning by goal number 16 on building peaceful, just and inclusive societies. Similarly, there can be no sustainable peace without the rule of law. In this regard, the essence of sustainable development goal 16 to promote the rule of law is not only a self-evident objective but also catalytic to all the goals. For nearly three decades, Sri Lanka was unable to fulfill her true potential because our preoccupation was addressing violent conflict that tore at the very fabric of our nation. All our resources were drained to combat terrorism and violent conflict when these resources should have been used for human development. This changed in 2015 after terrorism was defeated and a new administration elected. In order to prevent violent conflict, the global community must focus on human development. We know that extremist groups actively target vulnerable and marginalized communities, children, minorities, women and girls. We have seen that those most susceptible to false ideologies and hate speech of violent groups are those who are most desperate due to poverty, lack of opportunity, and no foreseeable means for upward mobility. Therefore, the eradication of poverty, educational reform, and increased social and economic opportunities is essential to counter human frustration and the threat of radicalization. We must approach development at local, national, regional and international levels and construct peace-building structures in new and innovative ways. It must not be a top-down approach but rather an inclusive, consultative process that carries the people with you. Vision for the future cannot be imposed on the people by an elite few. They must be shared and owned by all citizens. Achieving open, peaceful, just and inclusive societies. We in Sri Lanka have recognized the clear linkage between sustainable development and rule of law and good governance. Important constitutional amendments, for example, the 19th amendment to the constitution, reducing the presidential powers that was adopted following the political changes in Sri Lanka in January 2015, is far-reaching in the context of advancing good governance and rule of law and also the strengthening of democracy. Comprehensive constitutional reforms that are envisaged, including the incorporation of a bill of rights, will further consolidate good governance and rule of law in Sri Lanka. This is inextricably connected to the promotion of effective, accountable and transparent institution at all levels. After nearly 30 years of violent conflict, Sri Lanka has been able to embark on a journey towards accountability, reconciliation and lasting peace. In these 3 years in office, we have been able to pass a Right to Information Act and to establish an Office of Missing Persons. In January 2016, and as an integral part of our government's accountability and reconciliation process, an independent consultation task force on reconciliation mechanism was appointed entirely driven by civil society to conduct victim-centered public consultation on the design of the four mechanisms that would advance truth, justice, reconciliation, and non-recurrence in Sri Lanka. It is important to ensure that the main institutions of the executive, such as the public service and the police, remain independent, as well as the judiciary. To guarantee this, Sri Lanka established a constitutional council and set up independent commissions accountable only to the parliament for human rights, the judiciary, public service, the police, bribery and corruption, etc. These are the fundamentals for creating an open society. Implementation of the Sustainable Development Goal 16 in Sri Lanka must be seen in the context of the post-conflict reconciliation in the country. To this end, Sri Lanka also established a separate ministry for the implementation of the SDGs. The rise of violent extremism challenges the way we approach development. We need to rethink the role of development assistance and deal with the root causes of violent extremism. It is noteworthy that there has been, at the United Nations, a paradigm shift from countering violent extremism to preventing violent extremism, and that we are now focusing on causes rather than symptoms. In this regard, I would like to flag our 4 points. Number one, consensus. Consensus is important. Sri Lanka currently has a national unity government. Two traditional rivals in Sri Lankan politics have come together, ushering in a culture of consensual politics and the return of centrists to power in Sri Lanka. In the context of post-conflict Sri Lanka, the formation of the national unity government was essential in obtaining the bipartisan consensus necessary to face the challenges of peace building and constitution reform. Number two, engagement. It is vital to positively engage with the global community and the United Nations. This policy is reflected not only in our interactions with High Commissioner for Human Rights and the United Nations Peacebuilding Fund, but also with the UNDP. Number three, acknowledgement. It is important for the international community to recognize and acknowledge the efforts of a country as it addresses its past mistakes. It is also important for recurring United Nations reports not to merely repeat the old narrative, but to reflect the ground realities and the positive changes made by a country. This raises the morale of the country and its people and closes the space for extremism to interfere with the legitimate peace initiatives of a moderate government. Number four, inclusivity. The root causes of the conflict lie in the economic, linguistic, and social exclusion of groups. In order to build open, peaceful, just, and inclusive societies, it would be imperative to include women, youth, children, people with disabilities, and in particular, minorities and groups in vulnerable situations. This inclusivity is enshrined in our post-conflict reconciliation process. The Global Study on the Implementation of Resolution Number 1325, led by former Undersecretary General of the United Nations for Children and Armed Conflict, Ms. Radhika Kumaraswamy, a Sri Lankan, recognized the need to further efforts to involve and support the capacity of women across the spectrum of conflict prevention and peace building. The world has recognized the importance of involving women in conflict prevention and peace building efforts. Successful peace building requires gender equality and women's empowerment. Development investments are needed to ensure that youth are provided more opportunities to contribute as a positive force for the reduction of violent conflict and the building of peaceful societies. Present-day youths are increasingly susceptible to false propaganda and hate speech. Therefore, the kind of development investments we make must be mainly at local levels. Improving schools, providing skill sets that will ensure a reasonable wage through vocational training institutions, providing career guidance and opportunity-based seminars and interactive discussions, providing counseling to those youth in the former conflict area are just some of the ways we can address these issues. It is also important to foster innovation and entrepreneurship, which can sometimes be difficult to do in traditional societies. Effective educational reforms. If we are to promote the culture of peace, we must begin with our youth and in our school. It is in this context that childhood development becomes an imperative part of the conversation in the path to peace and reconciliation that Sri Lanka now boldly treads. The understanding of mind, the Buddha in his wisdom said that, I quote, Pabassara midam bhikkave chittang tanha ko agantukehi upakkilesi upakkile tam, I unquote. Which means, when a person is born, his mind is pure and free of defilements. His mind gets contaminated when defilements are absorbed from the external world. The reason behind that is the failure to understand the reality in the world. The root cause for all kinds of conflicts is based on avarice. The aim of education is meant to prevent the encroachment of such defilements into one's mind. As a country recovering from conflicts, we remain convinced that the only way to heal the wounds of division is by inculcating the values of empathy, oneness, inclusion, forgiveness, compassion, and love in our children while they are young and open to change. In addition, Sri Lanka's Office of National Unity and Reconciliation is working on educational sector reforms to incorporate national unity and reconciliation as a pillar within the education sector with a view to instilling in our children the importance of plurality. ONUR is also providing training to multi-religious leaders and clergy in peace building in order to use them as an early warning mechanism to defuse potential conflict situations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Honorable Minister of Higher Education and Cultural Affairs, Sri Lanka. They said in the real estate business, there are three things which are important. One is location, two is location, and three is location. For progress and development, also there are three words. One is education, two is education, three is education. Thank you, Mr. Patsa.